This conference will now be recorded.
Good afternoon, everyone. So this is the once again I thank all of you for being here. So we are when we started with Baby Criticare 2020, we have completed the sessions regarding traumatic brain injury, stroke, acute ischemic stroke, intrahepatic hemorrhage, and seizures, especially status epilepticus, decompressive craniectomy, as well as how to ventilate these neurosurgical patients. And also we have discussed, you know, the update on evidence-based neurocritical care. So the one topic which is missed, we'll try to cover, as I mentioned earlier, maybe in the Saturday or Monday, we may cover the part which has not discussed. So this time we are going to discuss on neuroradiology. So we have one well-known speaker, well-known radiologist in Bangalore, Dr. Shivakumar Swami, who is the senior consultant radiologist as well as head of the department radiology, HCG Hospital, Bangalore. Welcome you, Dr. Shivakumar Swami. So to moderate this session, we have our consultant intensivist, Dr. Lakshmikant from Gopalwada Shantideva Memorial Hospital. Welcome you again, Dr. Lakshmikant. So I will just hand over to Dr. Lakshmikant to proceed further.
Radiology is probably the one of the most important department in any hospital, for which most of the departments are dependent on, especially for diagnostic, therapeutic, intervention, it may be, especially the critical care department. Every day we do a lot of tests, imaging studies, which the radiologist has to interpret and guide us in managing the patient, diagnosing it, sometimes even the therapeutic interventions also. And all this while, they have been very kind enough to involve us into diagnosis part as well, like some of the clinical radiological skills have been transferred upon to the critical care people and physicians, like ultrasound, bedside, FAST, all that, very limited extent. And definitely, for all these reasons, having a very good radiologist to help us in critical care department, a good radiology setup in a hospital will add to the ease to us in to the great extent actually. And as like they can't be everywhere all the time, and as a clinician, critical care specialist, we also need to have some basic skills in interpreting the CT films, MRI films, Doppler study. So Dr. Shivakumar Swami is going to help us, teach us, and enlighten us on these aspects today based on neurocritical care, MRI, CT, and transcranial Doppler. Okay. And any queries, questions, discussions are welcome. Please be ready with the questions at the end of session. We'll have probably a very good discussion today. I once again thank Dr. Shivakumar Swami for having accepted the invitation. Dr. Shivakumar Swami, sir, please proceed.
Yeah. Thank you, organizers, especially Dr. Raghunath and Dr. Lakshmikant, for having me talk on this topic. So I have splitted the PPT because I was facing some issues. So I'll start the topic basically with an intention to, you know, guide during the critical care treatment aspects, especially on CT MRI. So my discussion will go hand in hand with CT and MRI at all the times, because it's not like, you know, you're going to do one modality and then keep quiet, because we have to take both the modalities into consideration, especially in an emergency setting. Whenever there's required, we will have to push for MR also if the patient is cooperative, and that is something which is important. So to start with, I'll start with a stroke. You know, when it comes to stroke, neuroimaging should be obtained in all those patients suspecting to have acute stroke or transient ischemic attack. The main intention is to differentiate between the ischemia that is this in fact from the hemorrhage. That's where most of the interventions will take place, and then if we should be able to differentiate if there is a hemorrhagic transformation or not, which will help the clinician to give the intra-arterial or intravenous thrombolytics. And imaging should also exclude other stroke mimics like tumor, and then not just the brain parenchyma, but we have to look at the major intracranial and the extracranial arteries where there can be a stenosis, occlusion, thrombosis, or even a tandem lesions which can be picked up on imaging, especially from the intracranial and its intracranial arteries and its branches. And the most other important thing is to determine the infarct core, which is the volume of the tissue that has already dead, and what is the tissue that is hibernating or some kind of hibernating brain parenchyma. We call this as penumbra, which can be salvageable, which is very important when we are considering any kind of interventions. Then, as I said, to look for the extent of potentially salvageable brain tissue, which is at risk of infection, which has developed some kind of stroke, but then has not completely dead. And then to guide the interventions, to look for to select the patients for thrombolysis, whether some patient is suitable for intravenous depending on the time of onset of the stroke, and then whether some patients may require mechanical thrombectomy also. So with that continuation of the same goals of acute stroke imaging, we have to keep four P's in mind. One is parenchyma, the other one is pipes, that is the blood vessels, then perfusion of the brain tissue, and then the penumbra, which is the brain parenchyma, which is kind of hibernating. So parenchyma, basically you are looking at early signs of stroke and we have to rule out the hemorrhage. Pipes, to assess all intra and extracranial circulation, that is the carotid and vertebral artery circulation. Perfusion, we have to look for the cerebral blood flow, blood volume, and the mean transit time. And then penumbra, as I said, it's to assess the risk of the dying of the ischemia. If we don't salvage this penumbra, then eventually it will go into complete infarction, and they are at high risk of developing hemorrhagic transformation, and then they may require decompression craniotomy also. So what we are interested in is whenever there is an acute stroke, we know that there will be some amount of ischemic core, which is a brain dead tissue as shown in this diagram, and the surrounding parenchyma, which is the penumbra, which is kind of hibernating, which is salvageable. So the whole purpose of doing an imaging is to look at this part of the brain parenchyma, and that can be performed with various imaging techniques, whether it's CT perfusion or MR perfusion. So this CT, this is the MR angiogram, CT angiogram study of the brain at the level of the ICA bifurcation. This is the right side MCA, which is clearly seen, whereas on the left side it is completely occluded. So there's complete occlusion of the left MCA, which has resulted in large area of stroke, and then this is the ischemic area core, and this is the penumbra. So this is what we are more concerned about, and not just at looking at the hemorrhage. So what do we choose? Do we choose CT or MRI? CT is most commonly used for triage of acute stroke patients because it's available everywhere and it's very rapid. I mean, with the newer multi-slice CT, we can actually take the CT scan of the brain within few seconds. And it is very useful in detecting acute intracranial hemorrhage. So the moment, it could be sometimes even venous hemorrhagic infarct. The patient comes with weakness and you don't know whether it is arterial or venous infarct, but at least a plain CT scan can definitely show if there is a hemorrhage or not. And then we can further proceed to do further imaging techniques to say whether it is a lobar hematoma or is it going to a arterial hematoma. Then CT is also useful in patients with contraindications to MRI, especially those with pacemakers may be contraindicated for MR imaging, and also many uncooperative patients with especially with somebody having stroke, they will be in a phase of raised ICP, they will be vomiting. These patients, it's very difficult to take them on MRI coach and do the scan for over 20-30 minutes. And of course, some patients are very phobic. We call this as claustrophobia, especially the MR gantry. It's like you're pushing the patient inside a tunnel, and it becomes very difficult that some patient may even complain that they're not able to breathe properly. So CT is very robust, it's fast, and it also identifies the early infarct signs, which is actually needs some amount of training to look at the CT images by changing the window and other things. And of course, major blood vessels, especially the MC, ART, basilar artery, or even the ICS can show acute blood clot within where we can detect. With CT in the same setting, we can also do CT angiography study by giving intravenous contrast and look at all the blood vessels, what we are dealing with. Is there any collateral formation, or are there any tandem lesions, or what is the extent of the thrombosis? And CT perfusion, again, that is very important. That is to decide on the endovascular thrombectomy, where you can look at the ischemic core and penumbra, that is salvageable tissue. And coming to MR in stroke imaging, MR should be used rather than CT only if it does not unduly delay the treatment for IV thrombolysis. If you think that there is definitely time and we can assess the brain parenchyma and also the blood vessels properly, and that is the scenario where we can quickly push these patients for MR, where it may take about 20 to 30 minutes roughly, depending on the patient cooperation. Now with the newer scanners, there are some algorithms where it can even account for the motion of the patients. And of all the important sequences, what we are very much concerned or wanting to do is the diffusion weighted imaging. It gives an excellent superior contrast of the tissue compared to the CT, especially for the stroke. And also we have to do susceptibility weighted imaging or the gradient imaging. The gradient is, again, we used to use this gradient imaging in the older scans, but now the newer MRs give susceptibility weighted imaging, which will show the bleed, hyperacute hemorrhage. One major problem with MR is that the availability, it's not readily available. And as I said, there are a few contraindications like pacemakers, uncooperative patient, and phobias. I think a CT is something which can be mounted even on a, if we start up a good stroke program, CT can be mounted on a mobile unit where any patient remotely presenting with, kind of ictus or weakness can be straight away taken to the CT, and they can actually triage based on the CT image whether the patient can be salvaged or treated for the stroke or not. So the next step is to look at the neurovascular imaging. We have to look at the blood vessels by doing the angiograph. It is simply a minimally invasive technique where you inject the contrast through one of the peripheral veins and look at the extra and intracranial circulation, mainly the circle of Willis and the vertebral vascular circulation, carotid bulbs, and other things. The CT and MR angiography is relatively non-invasive. Only thing is, on CT angiography, we may have to load quite an amount of iodinated contrast, which can be at times problematic because some patients, if they have pre-existing renal failure, then that is an issue. And even with borderline creatinine values, contrast-induced nephropathy can happen. Distal subtraction angiography, or the DSA, is pretty much reserved for performing the invasive procedures like thrombectomy or intra-arterial thrombolysis. DSA is not considered upfront for neurovascular imaging. We do this non-invasive imaging techniques, and then only we consider for DSA. And then where do we do advanced imaging? So we have discussed about the CT, MR, and then neurovascular imaging either by CT angiography or MR angiography. And then now we are looking at advanced imaging. This is in particularly looking at the brain injury and the brain perfusion status. Even CT can perform perfusion studies, and also MR can be utilized. CT, the problem is, again, you have to give additional dose of contrast. Now, newer techniques where they can perform both perfusion and CT angiography studies can be performed in the same go. Whereas MRI also requires gadolinium, but then the margin of renal failure, if we can do give MR contrast, that is the gadolinium, even if somebody has got clearance of 30 and above. But on the other hand, CT angiography, we cannot give iodinated contrast if the clearance is less than 60. So what are we looking at basically? In a multimodality MR setting for stroke, basically we are looking at MR angiography, then do a diffusion and perfusion studies. And on CT, we can do CT angiography and CT perfusion studies. So these advanced imaging should be performed if the findings are likely to influence the treatment, especially the decisions in making the endovascular interventions. Now that stroke window of 6 hours for the anterior circulation, and some reports for posterior circulation, even now they are doing up to 12 hours for posterior circulation. This is the scenario where you do advanced imaging. And the other intention of doing an advanced imaging is to estimate the size of the ischemic score and the hyperperfused but potentially salvageable brain parenchyma, which can be salvaged by giving the thrombolytic agents. Now let's look at the CT scan image. This is a non-contrast CT. Now we have two different window settings. You can see that, the window is wide, here it's narrow. So what do we see here? This is the left temporal lobe. This is a plain CT scan. You see a dense tube-like structure. So this is an acute thrombus that is sitting in the M1 segment of the MCA. And we can also see a clot slightly ahead where the MCA bifurcates, that is the junction of M2 seconds. We call this as hyperdense MCA sign and hyperdense MCA dot sign. Similar hyperdensity or high density can be also be seen in basilar artery, where if there's a basilar artery clot, we can see that basilar dot sign also. So this is one of the important finding, especially when you get a CT scan done for a stroke. Plain CT scan can give this information if there is any major clot in the large vessels. Of course, smaller vessels, it may be difficult, but there are some caveats where these kind of hyperdensity can be uniformly seen in all the blood vessels of the brain when there is increased hematocrit values. But we are not concerned with those cases because obviously those patients will not present with stroke. And moving on to other plain CT findings, we have to look at most important structures. Ideally, every slice should be imaged properly, assessed properly. Like in this case, this is at the level of the basal ganglia. You see this is on the left side, this is on the right side. You see a nice lentiform nucleus that is sitting on the right side, the basal ganglia. Here, if you see, the density is lost. So we can clearly make out that, the insular ribbon is also not very good as compared to the opposite side. This is a similar finding on in a different patient. You can see some hyperdensity in the basal ganglia, but then most of it is hypodense. We call this as low alternating area, which has come with infarction, acute infarction. So these are the early CT findings which can be picked up on CT scan. And the most important thing in looking at these kind of density changes is by changing the window manually, changing the window on a console or a computer, and make sure that this is not this is infarct or not. So this is what I was talking about. This is what we call a stroke window. So this is a routinely what we see. That looks like some vague hypodense area here. Then you change the window, but you can clearly make out that the posterior right basal ganglia is definitely hypodense compared to rest of the gray matter structures. That's when you say that there is infarct. So based on these kind of CT features, aspect score has been brought up. This is a very old score, but still very relevant in an acute setting of stroke, where This is primarily for the MCA territory circulation, where the regions are divided into 10 regions, which include M1 to M6, depending on the, this is M1 is the frontal lobes, M2 is slightly parietal, superior temporoparietal lobes, the M3 is parietal lobe, and higher sections where this is at the level of body of lateral ventricles. This is at the level of the basal ganglia. This is at the level of body of ventricles. Again, M4, M5, and M4. A score of 10 is given for each of these aspect score. Now, whenever you see an hypotensity, you minus the points based on the areas like M1. Like in this case, you see this hypotense area in the left frontal region, and then you bring out the score by, you know, one, and then the score becomes 9 out of 10. So that's how we do this. And again, in slightly higher section, you see this M1 and also M4 also is showing hypertensity. So these are the acute stroke findings what we get. And in a same setting, if you look at this kind of finding, that is the hypertense MCSA, and where there's an acute clot within the MCA, then you do perform the CT angiography in the same setting and show that this MCA is completely occluded and there are not much of collaterals that has developed or even otherwise. And this is the coronal CT angiography study showing complete cutoff of the left MCA. This is an ideal candidate for mechanical thrombectomy or intra-arterial thrombolysis. If the patient has crossed beyond 3 hours, I think this patient will definitely benefit from intra-arterial thrombolysis. And once you do this CT angiography study, then you can assess on table and decide to perform the CT perfusion. This is the sequence of events what we do in imaging. So we know that there is an acute MCA thrombosis, which is called an MCA territory infarct. And now you do this CT perfusion to look at the ischemic core and the ischemic penumbra. So, and if you compare the opposite side, the left side where the MCA territory is there, this is an ischemic core where there's absolutely no cerebral blood flow happening there, and this whole area is the ischemic penumbra, which can be salvaged. So on the contralateral side, you see a nicely perfused brain, but on the infarcted side, you see this ischemic penumbra, which can be salvaged by doing the intervention or intravenous thrombolysis. And this is a different patient. You see this large low perfused area. This is already an infected core, but there is some amount of salvageable tissue which is lying all around this core. So this is what we are looking. This is the cerebral blood flow map, CBF, what we call. And on the contrary, this image is the mean transit time or MTT map, what we call mean transit time or time to peak map, will show increased time required for the contrast to reach this because there is an occlusion. So MTT map will show the complete area which has hypoperfused or the contrast is not able to reach this parenchyma. Now let's move on to MR. We have looked at the plain CT scan image and then contrast angiography and then perfusion study. Generally, when we do an MRI, this is a T2 weighted image and this is a flare image. These are basic sequences which are very important. And how do we make out T2? T2 is like CSF spaces are all bright. We call it as hyper intensity. And on a flare image, all the CSF spaces which were bright on T2 will be suppressed. We call this as fluid inversion recovery sequence or the flare sequence. CSF signals are suppressed, and that's how this is kind of subtracted image. But then because there is an infarcted tissue, this is the area which we are looking at. And these kind of findings on this routine MR sequences are not picked up in up to 4 to 4.5 hours of time. So we may be losing just by doing this kind of MR sequence in very early phase. The MR signal evolves over time. So that's why what is important in MR is the diffusion weighted imaging, which is very sensitive. I mean, in acute phase, it will show the signal abnormality very fast. You know, this becomes a bright signal. In acute phase, up to 4 hours, T2 and flare may not show any signal at all. But over time, the slight signal intensity develops on TT weighted imaging, but diffusion is very sensitive, and the counterpart, that is the apparent diffusion coefficient, which is obtained from the diffusion weighted imaging, wherever the bright areas are there, that turns black on ADC or the apparent diffusion coefficient. So there's, why do we obtain ADC? The ADC is very important because, again, it's diffusion weighted imaging is the Brownian movement of the water molecules. There is a restriction because of the edema and then infarct, what happens with the brain tissue, and this restriction will be reflected as black area and ADC. This is very important because sometimes what happens is there is pseudo normalization of diffusion weighted imaging or T2 shine through, what we call, because again it follows the signals of CSF. Sometimes if you only obtain DWA, it may not be very useful in stroke imaging. So MR is very important, but the routine minimal sequence, if you take T1 and T2, may not be sufficient at all. So we will have to do diffusion weighted imaging. So these are this different case series of, you know, acute stroke where you are seeing bright signal changes. This is in the PCA circulation, the left PCA circulation involving the occipital lobe and the posterior medial hippocampus area. And this is again anterior circulation. You see the spericulosal arteries which have been infarcted, and you see the area which is circulated by the ACA is completely infarcted. This is a hyperacute stroke where diffusion will show bright signal changes. And again, this one is an MCA territory infarct. Now, if you look at this image, this is a CT scan image. If you apply aspect score, maybe we can see a subtle hyperdensity in this area. Okay, we may not be completely able to assess what is the extent of the infarct, but then there are some periventricular white matter signals. These could be some chronic small vessel ischemic changes. We don't know which area we are dealing with, whether it's an acute infarct or a chronic small vessel ischemic changes. But then when you do an MRI, you can clearly see, you know, the hyperintensity and the diffusion weighted imaging, which will lights up like a light bulb, and we can say that this is the acute infarcted area where the MCA territory is involved. There is also a small focus of lacunar acute infarct in the right caudate head. Probably we are dealing with an embolic infarct. So there's something called as diffusion and flare mismatch. You know, generally, as I said, flare signal may not be seen up to 4 hours of 4 or 4 to 5 hours of stroke, and diffusion is very sensitive. And when you do an imaging, if you don't see any signal on the flare imaging, and if you see signal changes on diffusion imaging, we call this as diffusion flare mismatch. That means to say the time of onset of stroke is less than 4.5 hours. Similar, same case with involving the basal ganglia. You don't see any signal changes in the flare, but diffusion is lighting up. So this is, there is no mismatch here because you already see that there is some subtle flare hyperintensity in the MCA territory. Diffusion is also showing, but what we can conclude that the stroke, onset of stroke is probably more than 4.5 hours. We have already noticed the flare signal changes. So this is also an important technique to assess the time of onset of the stroke. Now let's move on to perfusion weighted imaging. So perfusion weighted imaging is useful to reveal the ischemic region, as I said, in the brain. In contrast, diffusion weighted imaging will show the ischemic injury and not the ischemia itself. So perfusion will show cerebral blood flow, mean transit wall time, and time to peak, that is the TTP, and time to peak for the residual function. How do we do this perfusion? Basically, it's this T2 star, what we call, where you give the gadolinium and track the gadolinium bolus through the neuroparenchyma. This is called T2 star imaging when you do this with gadolinium. So perfusion in this is something very robust technique compared to other techniques of perfusion weighted imaging on MRI, where you get all these parameters with this scope. On the other hand, without giving gadolinium or the MR contrast, we can obtain arterial spin labeling technique, which doesn't require, you know, contrast to be given, but also this is equally sensitive. It shows the cerebral blood flow, which is actually sufficient enough for us to make most of the decision. This is an additional software that has to be brought up with the MRI. So this is the whole spectrum of stroke imaging. What we see, you do a routine sequence, that is T1 flare, T2, and then this is the gradient of the susceptibility weighted imaging, MR angio, diffusion, ADC, and cerebral blood flow, blood volume, mean transit time, and time to peak. So this how the sequence of imaging shows. And if you look at this particular MR angio, probably we can say that there is slight paucity of vessels in the left MCA, distal MCA territory. You don't see any signal abnormality on the T1 weighted imaging, but then your gradient sequence shows some increased vascularity or the hypointensity, probably because this patient is developing collaterals from the ECA circulation. Diffusion, though it is very sensitive, it is only showing small areas of infarct. On the other hand, in the same corresponding diffusion sequence, the ADC is showing black areas. So it shows that there is definitely acute, hyperacute infarct, but not to that extent. But when you do a perfusion study, this is a CBV map. The CBV is more or less absolutely normal because the brain autoregulation mechanism is working. On the other hand, the CBV, that is the cerebral blood volume, is slightly increased because the autoregulation methods, and MTT and TTP shows that there is slightly increased time to reach the for the contrast to reach this area. So on a routine sequence, you may hardly say that there are only small areas of acute influx, but if you do a proper perfusion study, you will definitely make out what is the extent of ischemia that brain is going through. That's what the MR perfusion is. That's where the MR perfusion technique is very important in these settings. We should also talk about perfusion diffusion mismatch, because diffusion will show the ischemic core. We are interested in looking at the ischemic penumbra. This is an ADC map. This is color coded actually. Generally, you see this black area and the infarcted, that is a restricted area. You see a large area of restricted diffusion, and the mean transit time shows large area of increased mean transit time. This is a T2 flare. So definitely it means that a stroke has happened quite some time. So basically you're not seeing any kind of mismatch between the diffusion or the ADC and the mean transit time. On the other hand, this is the diffusion perfusion mismatch. You see this ADC map, there's only small area of low signal in this right MCA territory, but the mean transit time shows a large area of defect. So this is the mismatch. So we are more concerned with this extra brain tissue which can be salvaged. And flare, though it is the time of onset of stroke is slightly more than 4 or 5 hours, but then this is hypoperfused area which can be salvaged by giving thrombolytics. There are a few other cases. This is one of the cases which was where endovascular procedure was done for stroke. This was a basal ganglia infarct. This is a diffusion weighted imaging, but then post procedure this patient initially had a small hemorrhagic focus. So susceptibility weighted imaging is very important, and then eventually this small hemorrhagic focus increased in size and become a obvious hematoma in the infected area. A similar case on the left side, where this was the initial infected tissue which was thrombolyzed, but then eventually this patient developed procedure related hematoma with intraventricular extension. You see the blood clot already going into the lateral ventricles. Now, apart from diffusion weighted and perfusion weighted images, what we are supposed to acquire is the high susceptibility weighted sequences. I have shown a couple of images now. The susceptibility weighted images are basically T2 star or the gradient images. So they are the counterpart of the CT, where you see a tube like hyperdense bright structure. These susceptibility weighted images can also show a clot in the major blood vessel. So like in this case, you see this acute MCA, distal M1 MCA obstruction. There are absolutely no blood vessels in the M2, M3 areas. Flare is hardly showing any signal changes, but diffusion shows a slightly larger area of infarcted tissue. And this is the susceptibility weighted image. You see a clot that is sitting in the distal MCA and also M2. And if you look at the susceptibility weighted image more cranially towards the MCA circulation, there is definitely increased vascular structures in the sulci, which shows that there is some autoregulation that is happening. And this is the perfusion mismatch. So diffusion is very small area and perfusion is showing large area of hypoperfused brain tissue, which can be salvaged. And this is the cerebral blood flow, mean transit time and tide to peak air maps, which shows that it's not the small area that that is seen in the diffusion. And this is what we are interested in, looking at perfusion and diffusion mismatch. Another case, this patient had a small area of stroke. It was very difficult to see on routine flare T1 or T2 weighted sequences, but eventually the susceptibility weighted gradient images also did not show, but then the high MIP susceptibility weighted image showed a small hemorrhagic focus. So we have to keep these hemorrhagic areas into account, because if there is a hemorrhage, the chances of hematoma or the hemorrhage becoming more with thrombolysis is high, and the clinician has to make that kind of decision whether to treat or not is very important based on the MR image. So these kind of small hemorrhages are very difficult to be picked up on CT scan images. That's where MR comes into picture. And this is another case. This is a patient of leukemia, came with altered sensorium and suspected some kind of stroke, or you know, patient was not responsive, and then routine MR sequences was more or less normal except for some area of gliosis and some sulci showed some hypointensities. So this T2 weighted sequence was suggesting that there could be some amount of bleed. MR angio was absolutely normal here, but then when you do susceptibility weighted image, you see extensive cortical and subcortical microhemorrhages. These can be seen only with susceptibility weighted imaging. These are my acute microhemorrhages that can be seen with seen on brain. So this is not a major vascular occlusion or a stroke. This is basically microhemorrhages related to pre-existing leukemic disease as such. Over time, the acute stroke will become subacute, you know, where there is pseudo-normalization of diffusion weighted. This stroke, this area in the right occipital region was earlier showing bright. Now it is normal on a diffusion weighted imaging. We call this a pseudo-normalization, though we know that there's a already infarcted tissue, and T2 shows slight hyperintensity area. This is a completely gliotic tissue, more or less going into complete gliosis. And this is T1 weighted imaging without contrast. You see this cortical hyperintensity, that's we call it as some kind of ribbon signal intensity, which is the subacute phase of the infarct. During this phase, if we give contrast, this area, infarcted area, will enhance. So stroke in subacute phase will enhance, and sometimes, rarely, it can mimic like a tumor or some kind of encephalitis. So we have to keep that in mind. What was the time of onset of the symptoms, and also when we are imaging. So this is an image. We have seen acute phase, subacute phase, and now moving on to chronic infarct. This is a completely encephalomyelitic changes in the right frontal and insula and the basal ganglia area. This is a chronic right MCA infarct. So this tissue is completely dead and is filled up by the CSF. The same thing here on a T2 weighted and flare imaging, which shows completely gliotic tissue. And you see that some amount of flare hyperintensity along the margins. Apart from this, because there is a gliotic tissue, there's slight exvacute dilatation of the left lateral ventricle, which the gliotic tissue itself will pulls up because of the filled up CSF. So now I've finished stroke, and let's move on to the other aspect of critical care imaging. The second part is intracranial hemorrhage and traumatic brain injuries. Again, even in these settings, CT and MRI are very important. So basically, in any of this ICH or traumatic brain injury, what we are looking at? We are looking at intraparenchyal hematomas, lobar hematomas, then SAH, SDH, EDH, and all those things. CT is again first line of investigation for all this. Angiogram only when clinically indicated, when if there is a need for to do perform the angiogram study or the contrast study, that's when we give contrast in on CT. And of course, MRI is also very important investigation in case of in assessing the intracranial hemorrhage and traumatic brain injury. When it comes to MRI for any kind of traumatic brain injury or intracranial hematomas, so these are the basic sequences what we are generally keen on. We have to do 3D T1 weighted imaging, that's a high resolution T1, T2 weighted imaging, at least two planes can be performed, T2 axial and coronal, then flare, diffusion weighted, susceptibility weighted imaging. So either susceptibility weighted imaging or gradient imaging is something what alternatively we can do, whether it's 1.5T or 3T. These sequences are must for more or less all cases. Over and above, once you decide that there is hematoma, there is trauma related changes, we may not perform any kind of angiography study or even perfusion studies based on the initial imaging. When it comes to hematoma, the MR sequences are can vary. On CT, it is like either you see an acute hematoma or subacute hematoma and completely gliotic tissue, which may not show hematoma at all. But on MRI, we can actually differentiate the age of the hematoma. So this is an appearance of the blood on the MR sequences over time. Depend if it is hyperacute or acute or early subacute, late subacute or chronic. So in hyperacute, in hematoma, what we see is the oxyhemoglobin. In acute phase, you have deoxyhemoglobin. In early subacute and late subacute, we have methemoglobin. And chronic, basically, you see a rim of hemosiderin staining or hemochromes, and centers will have hemochromes. So these molecules are the one which give signals on T1 and T2 weighted images. So for a clinician, I think it's even in ICU setting, if you want to look at the assess the hematoma, this table will definitely help. You should always paste this chart. We do this because routinely it becomes very difficult sometimes when the patient present with. So in an hyperacute hematoma, intraparenchyma hematoma, T1 will be ISO or normal. There won't be any signal changes. T2 will be hyper. On gradient or the susceptibility weighted imaging, it will be bright with a rim of black line or hypointensity, what we call. In acute phase, that is 1 to 3 days, you see slightly hypointensity on T1. Then it becomes hypointense on T2 with a rim of edema. Then hypointensity or the complete blackness on the gradient sequence. And early subacute, we see bright on T1, which will be again bright on T2, but then there is surrounding edema, which will look like as though it's slightly bigger. And then in the early subacute, you see it's the blackness coming down with, however, a margin of blackness still persists. So these are the sequence of signal changes that happens with MR in a case of acute hematoma. It's always good to print this chart and then keep it in the ICU room to assess the age of the blood. So let's look at different kinds of hematoma. Basically, the extradural hematoma, where the blood collects in the potential spaces between the inner table of the skull and the dura. It can be arterial or venous in origin. Arterial epidural hematoma are quite common, and they arise from laceration of the meningeal arteries. Generally, what happens is there is a calvarial fracture. Adjacent to that is an EDH or the extradural hematoma. It is usually a lenticular shape hematoma which crosses the dural attachment site but will not cross the sutures. So EDH will not cross the sutures, and this venous EDH or occur due to laceration of the dural sinuses in conjunction with fractures of the overlying skull. These can be of variable shape. Generally, arterial EDH are usually lenticular shape. So the other important is the subdural hematoma. Usually it happens due to it. Many a times it is spontaneous also, if not traumatic. So even with somebody on blood thinners or minor blood dyskinesias, they can present with subdural hematomas. The injury is basically due to the injury to the bridging veins that traverse the subdural spaces connecting the brain and the dural sinuses. It can come in interhemispheric fissure along the tentorial leaf, especially in the pediatric age group. If we also call it as shaken baby syndrome. If you see a child with SDH along the interhemispheric fissure and the tentorium, we generally ask for any violence that has happened with the kid from shaking. They are usually crescentic collection within the brain and the inner table of the skull. Different type of SDH. This is based on the age. This is the acute SDH, which is hyperdense or bright on a CT scan image. You see this hyperdense SDH, which is all along the convexity of the left cerebral hemisphere. There's significant displacement of the brain. You see a midline shift. How do we measure midline shift? Is you draw a line along the you draw a line like this, and the septum, what this distance is what is measured as midline shift. This is kind of no objective way of assessing what is happening, whether the hematoma is evolving or resolving. So this is an acute SDH in the convexity where the hematoma is bright. This is subacute where it becomes this signal, the density of the hematoma is similar to the brain parenchyma. It will be ISO. So these are the scenarios where we may miss these hematomas, subacute hematomas. It is very important that you change the window and look at the gyral pattern and the sulci pattern. Obviously, on the contralateral side, you see a lot of the sulci, but here it is completely lost. You have to make changes in the window. And if you have doubt, we can always give contrast and assess the brain parenchyma from the hematoma. In late phase of the chronic subdural hematoma, the collection becomes completely like a CSF density, though it gives some mass effect with midline shift, but hematoma will completely become of CSF density. And many a times, quite often, we see acute or chronic, where there's a chronic SDH where repeated hematoma keeps happening. So let's look at multiple images. This is a lenticular shape extradural hematoma. You see this hematoma here, and then there's mass effect on the brain. You see the adjacent fracture also. So whenever there's a fracture, generally they develop EDH on the same side. On the other hand, SDH developed from the contrecoup pattern with parenchymal hemorrhages. This is again lentiform shape MR brain image showing acute hematoma. This is along the transverse sinus. There is rupture of the one of the tarcula and the left transverse sinus with venous extradural hematomas. And this is another anterior temporal convexity, small extradural hematomas. So it is very important to change the window and see, because these hematomas are placed peripherally. And if you don't change the window properly, the density of the skull will sometimes mask these hematomas. It is very important to locate these. Apart from that, CT may sometimes not show the contrecoup injuries, but MR, this is the same case where you see this hematoma there and parenchymal hemorrhages also. This is the sagittal T1 showing anterior temporal hematoma. On the other hand, this is the SDH, which is acute SDH on the convexity and also the interhemispheric fissure. There's mass effect. This will be a crescent shape running all along the convexity. Most of the time they cross the suture lines. This is the tentorial hematoma, which is going along the tentorium. This is subacute hematoma. You see the density is matching with that of the gray matter of the brain, and if in doubt, we can always give contrast and see the dural reflection enhancement, like what they have done here to assess the subacute hematoma. This is again T2 flare image showing the hyperintense subdural hematoma. This is again, as I said, there can be repeated hemorrhage within the STH. This is the acute on chronic STH, where there's pre-existing chronic STH over which again acute hematoma has happened. Even the interhemispheric fissure is showing hematoma with mass effect and left midline shift. Apart from the bone windowing, we should brain parenchymal windowing, we should always change the CT bone window. CT is the modality for look at the calvarial fracture, not just focal area. We can always trace the fracture line, which is very important, and hematomas can occur all the way along the fracture line, the extra, especially the extradural hematoma, and the contracooked part will show parenchymal hemorrhages and STH. This is a case where there is an occipital bone fracture and also the injury of the right transverse sinus, which is completely thrombosed now, and even the sigmoid sinus is showing complete thrombosis, which is going up to the jugular vein. So this is very important, where you know the fracture has disrupted the transverse sinus with leading to thrombosis and also the EDH. Moving on to subarachnoid hemorrhage, in one of the European series said that SAH is associated in nearly 40% of patients with moderate to severe head injury. So it is very common, especially in traumatic setting, but if there is no history of trauma, if somebody comes with spontaneous SAH, we should always do the angiogram to see if there is any aneurysm or avascular malformation. So where does this happen? They generally sit in the sulcal spaces. So acute SAH appear as curvilinear hyperdensity on CT scan within the cortical sulci or the sylvian fissures, like in this case. This is in the sylvian fissure. This is in the interhemispheric fissure. You see this thin SAH in the interpeduncular system. And this is on MR, where you see the sulci T2 hypointensity on gradient imaging. Though flare is showing very small area of signal abnormality, T1 is still more not that sensitive. T2 is showing slight signal changes, but susceptibility weighted imaging is something which is very important that we do in all cases of SAH. SAH, there can be adjacent cortical contusion, which will be picked up on diffusion weighted imaging. So more or less in all cases of stroke or intracranial hemorrhage, we do this routine sequences to make sure the extent of hematoma and also the adjacent parenchymal changes. There's something called as fissure grade, which is commonly described for SAH, which now they have modified it. The original fissure group one says that there's no blood detected. Group two is a diffuse deposition of or thin layer of blood in the interhemispheric fissure, insula system and ambient system. The thickness is usually less than 1 mm. Group three is localized clots in particular area with vertical layers of blood more than 1 mm. Apart from the SH of 1 mm thickness, there will be focal clots within the subarachnoid spaces is group three. Group four is intracerebellar or intraventricular clots, which is quite extensive with diffuse or no subarachnoid hemorrhages. So all the parenchymal and intraventricular clots are grouped into group four. And then came the modified Fischer scale, which says that where they are slightly modified based on the they're not taken measurements into consideration. Group zero is no SAH or IVH. Group one is minimal SAH with no IVH, that is intraventricular hemorrhage. Group two is minimal SAH with bilateral intraventricular hemorrhage. Group three is thick SAH, that is completely filling the cistern of the fissure, where you won't see make out the cistern or the fissure with bilateral intraventricular hemorrhage. Then group four is thick SAH, that is completely filling one or more cisterns with bilateral IVH. Now there's something called as intraventricular hematoma volume, parenchymal hematoma, acute hematomas which appear bright on T1 on CT scan images. The volume has to be measured because this will give the long-term outcomes. How do we measure? In the initial phases, they used to take the number of slices of the CT into consideration like this, you stack the hematoma from the from top to bottom. Basically, you are going to measure the longest diameter, and exactly at 90 degrees, you measure one more measurement, and then consider the slice thickness and also the interslice gap, and measure the vertical height. But now with the newer advent of CT scan, it's always good you do a reformat exactly based on the initial measurements and look for the craniocaudal extension of the hematoma. I can always assess the perihematoma edema, mass effect, and also midline shift. IVH generally it is considered as a type of intraaxial injury by some of the authors, and primarily it happens with traumatic brain injury or intracranial hematoma, or even in contusions. They happen because of the tear in the subependymal veins due to rotational injuries, or sometimes even a large lobar hematoma can directly go into the ventricular lumen by disruption. And 60% of traumatic traumatic brain injury with involvement of the corpus callosum will show invariably intraventricular hemorrhage. So this is the case where you see this bright thing that is filling up the posterior third ventricle. This is an intraventricular hematoma. There's an associated left thalamic hematoma which has gone into the third ventricle. And eventually one also, there is, because the patient is lying supine, you see this fluid level within the occipital horns of the lateral ventricle. These are quite often missed on imaging, even by the radiologist, because generally if you don't see any hematoma in the parenchyma or third ventricle, spontaneous hematomas, intraventricular hematomas can happen. It is very sensitive index that you see the occipital horns, and that's where even the diffusion weighted imaging is very sensitive. It will show brightness on these kind of intraventricular hematomas. So traumatic axonal injury or the brain injury is the rotational strain that manifests as scattered or often bilateral small white matter lesions, which can show hemorrhage or without hemorrhagic components. So when you see a traumatic axonal injury greater than 3 foci, that is evident on radiologically with involvement of 2 separate lobes of the brain and the corpus callosum, then you apply the term as diffuse axonal injury, where the injury is along the white matter tracts. Grade 1 injuries generally involve the lobar white matter, particularly Grewite junction, especially the frontal and temporal lobes. Grade 2 injuries involve the corpus callosum, especially the posterior corpus callosum or the splenium. Grade 3 injuries involve the dorsolateral aspect of the upper brainstem. To pick up traumatic brain injuries, CT is very insensitive. In fact, we may routinely miss traumatic axonal injuries on CT. If you suspect any kind of axonal injury, you should always get an MRI done. So this is what MR sensitive. So in MR, it is very imperative that we do the apart from routine sequences, we have to do the susceptibly weighted imaging and the diffusion weighted imaging. You see this microhemorrhages linear along the tracts in the brainstem. This is the coronal image, and also this is the axial image. You see a frontal subcortical traumatic brain axonal injury with involvement of the corpus callosum, that is the splenium, which is showing bright signal changes. This is some more cases of traumatic brain injury. This is a diffuse SH, which is happening. You see that cells are completely filled with blood with associated SDH in the left side. There's some amount of SDH also in the on the right side. So the brightness of the skull will, you know, sometimes may not show the SDH properly. So we have to do different windowing and see to look for the SH and also associated SDH also. These patients with traumatic brain injury, they can also come with scalp hematoma and associated skull fracture. This is an attenuated MR images, and this is the gradient image. You see that SH that is seen in the sulcal spaces of bilateral parietal lobes. Few more images of the traumatic injury where there is an acute intraparenchymal hematoma in the right temporal lobe with left anterior temporal EDH. Probably there is a fracture sitting. Yes, there is a fracture sitting here. So this fracture adjacent to that, there will be extradural hematoma. This eventually, this parenchymal hematoma grown to large extent, and there was an associated epidural hematoma, and now this patient is having large significant amount of midline shift because of the acute EDH. So this particular, there is hemorrhagic contusion in the temporal lobe associated SDH. We are not seeing the SDH in this window, but when you change the window, you can clearly make out the SDH here, and there is definite SH. So there are three components in this patient. There is SDH, which is well seen on widening the window on CT scan, SH, and also intraparenchymal hematoma. Another case with SDH in the left temporal and parietal convexity, as we go up, there is the thickness of the hematoma is significantly high. It's completely involved in the hemisphere. There's some amount of hyperdensity in the interhemispheric fissure. There's SDH along the sphax also with significant mass effect on the left lateral ventricle. You see this left lateral ventricle is completely squashed, and there is uncal herniation. You see the temporal medial temporal lobe coming all the way to the superior suprasella cistern, and this we measure the midline shift based on the septum, and this will be like on serial follow-up we can say whether the patient is deteriorating or not. This is how we measure the midline shift for any of these cases, especially with the SDH or even EDH in the scenario. Few more images of traumatic axonal injury. You see hemorrhagic contusion CS in the right cerebellum. CT, as I said, CT is not that sensitive. You see a small focus of hemorrhage here, but then MR is showing a lot more lesions here, which evolving into multiple foci. Not just that area. If you see this basifrontal and the temporal region, CT is not showing any lesions, but MR has picked up significant amount of microhemorrhages, traumatic microhemorrhages in the occipital, temporal, frontal, and also in the high frontal areas. So MR is very sensitive. In fact, CT is basically to look at the fracture, associated fracture, but then MR will show all type of parenchymal bleed in, and also axonal injury in these patients. Another case, this is left frontal hemorrhagic contusion. Basically, these contusions happen along the thick bone ridges, especially the petrous or the spinoid wings. This eventually has increased in no time, and these hematomas have significantly increased. They are getting coalesced, and large hematoma is being formed over time. Another lobar hematoma. This is a large lobar hematoma. This is actually the right basal ganglia bleed. You see this large hematoma. In a setting of hypertension, this can be called as hypertensive bleed. And when you do contrast, you see the active contrast blush here. This is the spot sign, what we call it as. This is the classical spot sign where the bleeding is happening in the basal ganglia area, and the delayed scan will show pulling up of contrast in that region. So if you do contrast, definitely it will help to look at the area of active bleed happening. So this is a lobar hematoma which can happen with amyloid angiopathy or even venous infarct. This is like kind of this does not go with the arterial territory. So definitely this is involving multiple lobes, and then with significant perilesional edema, it happens as though it's the edema goes in a fashion of glove where you put a fingers in the glove. This bleed and the edema will form. This is lobar hematoma. In such cases, it is always important to look for MR venogram and see if there is any major dural sinus or cortical venous thrombosis is there. And this is the susceptibility-related imaging. The hematoma shows bright with black rim. And in fact, MR will show larger extent of the hematoma because CT is very much limited to temporal lobe here. It is involving more than two or three lobes. Again, this is chronic microhemorrhages in a setting where there is absolutely no findings on routine MR sequences, but you see SH on susceptibility weighted imaging. So it is very important we do susceptibility weighted imaging in all these sequences, in all these patients, to look for microhemorrhages also. This is another case where, you know, this patient underwent craniotomy, but then there was some hyperdensity because of this post-surgical bleed happened. There is compression of the vessel and this cerebellum was completely infarcted. So these are some of the things which we should keep in mind, especially when you do a follow-up post-neurosurgical assessment. You have to keep looking at the size of the hematoma in a serial fashion. Any of these cases should be always compared with the prior to look for what is happening with to the hematoma. And if you think that there is an infarct happening, because just based on the CT, the perilesional edema may not show the infarcted area completely, but it is very important we do diffusion weighted imaging in this, in these cases. This is a classical case of SH completely involving the basal cistern, thick. We can call this as grade 4 with, there is a grade 4 fissure grading with IVH. All the basal cisterns are effaced and you do angiography, CT angiography study. This is 3D volume rendering. You see an ACOM aneurysm this sitting here. When we do angiography in these settings, there may be some multiple aneurysms which can be picked up on MR angiography. So it is important that when you see thick basal SH with no history of trauma, it's always advisable that we do CT angiography in the same setting to look for any bleeding aneurysms. Now, coming to the last part of the talk, I think I'm already crossing the time. Is that okay?
That's fine. Please
continue. I'm more or less done. So, next topic is hydrocephalus, especially in acute sending. I think in critical care, it's the acute hydrocephalus which is very important rather than ongoing or a chronically treated one. So basically, any hydrocephalus, we have to look for whether it is communicating or non-communicating. Eventually, it is all the blockage of the CSF circulation, whether it's at the ventricular level or at the subarachnoid space level. So this is the classical finding of acute hydrocephalus. This patient, this is the CT with a lot of SH. You see this, the Sylvian features on the intramesial fissure. You see a lot of basal cistern effacement. And because of the SH, there is intraventricular bleed, the ventricle starts dilated. How do we know that this is an acute hydrocephalus? In acute hydrocephalus, these periventricular regions, these periventricular white matter areas will show seeping of the CSF fluid because of the acute pressure. You see hypodensities or low attenuation on the CT scan images. So this is an acute hydrocephalus. It looks as though it's very angry. Similar on MR, you see periventricular flare signal changes. So to pick up the acute hydrocephalus findings, we have to do diffusion and also flare imaging. That is very important. These two sequences will show whether it's an acute hydrocephalus or not, because chronic may not require acute intervention, but these are the areas where periventricular flare signal changes. If we pick up, then we can always say that this is an acute hydrocephalus and intervention is required. This is a chronic hydrocephalus. You can do all these measurements. This is a case of NPH as the normal pressure hydrocephalus, where the corpus callosum gets ballooned out. You see the lateral ventricles prominent, dilated more than the sulcal spaces. They are also associated with other clinical findings, especially with bladder, urinary bladder incompetence, and also memory loss. Moving on to next imaging is the brain dead. On CT, you see completely hypodense. There is absolutely no gray-white differentiation. Even the deep gray structures, the basal ganglia and thalami, are also hypodense. All the ventricles are squashed. You don't see any cell say diffusely hypodense. The tentorium they look slightly bright. There could be an element of STH, but then this is primarily because rest of the brain, there is a lot of fluid and the edema are that has happened, which is a sign of brain dead on imaging. So you see this kind of picture, it's an Aunt Minnie, what we call, it's completely brain dead. And similarly on MR, though we can see some amount of gray white differentiation, the cortex are all swollen, the deep gray structures are all swollen, there's complete effacement of the ventricles and also the sulci. And if you do MR angiography, there won't be absolutely any signal obtained from these intracranial vessels. So next topic that has been asked is the transcranial Doppler. Though I have stopped doing this, I think critical care specialists, they do a lot of these procedures routinely, because generally we get carotid Dopplers to do, but TCD is something which has to be obtained immediately, and most of the clinicians are doing this now. What we need is a high low frequency probe, because it has to traverse through the calvarium. So they are small probes, you know, they usually measure the cerebral blood flow. It is relatively inexpensive, it is repeatable, and it can be done on a portable basis. One problem with TCD is that operator dependent. Somebody has to, you know, what I would suggest is everybody who's involved in critical care, if you have the probe, it's always good to keep doing TCD on each and every patient. Sometimes even on yourself also, it is always good. Basically, this TCD, the current application is to look at the vasospasm, especially in sickle cell disease or SAH, who come with aneurysm bleeds or traumatic bleeds, and also to look for intra and extracranial stenosis or occlusion. Some areas where it is also used is to look for brainstem death, where if you look do a TCD, we may not get any kind of flow within the intracranial vessels. Then head injury, raised intracranial pressures, intraoperative monitoring, cerebral embolism, and to look for autoregulatory testing of brain vessels. So this is the frame that can be obtained. There are few frames that are now available, commercially available. If we don't have this frame, you can directly place the probe on the temporal region. This is the commonest site for TCD placement of the probe. What are the other acoustic windows apart from this temporal area, temporal region? Basically, transtemporal window is frequently done, where, because we can see most of the blood vessels in this area, especially the terminal board of the ICA, MCA, ACA, PCA. All this can be visualized in the transtemporal approach. Other areas include suboccipital, that is posterior to the posteriorly. We can look at the posterior circulation. Transorbital can also be done, and submandibular, the retromandibular area can also be utilized to look at this. So this ultrasound beam has to go beyond the bone thing. TCD should not be confused with neurosonogram. Neurosonogram is generally done with in pediatric age group, because you have this fontanelles that is open. You can directly place the probe even with a 6 megahertz probe or 10 megahertz probe can be easily placed. There is no bone there. You can see the brain parenchyma and also applied Doppler there. But TCD, on the other hand, are smaller probes, which it is exclusively used to look at the blood vessels and not for the brain parenchyma. So what indices what we see, what we get in TCD is the mean flow velocity, which is the central parameter for TCD. And it is given by a formula that is the peak systolic velocity plus end diastolic volume end diastolic velocity into 2/3. So the mean flow velocity is increased with stenosis, vasospasm, and or hyperdynamic flow, and decreased with hypotension, decreasing cerebral blood flow, intracranial increased ICP, or brain dead. TCD can also give us some information on the focal arterial stenosis or vasospasm, which is represented by increased values within 5 to 10 or less than a centimeter segment, usually by more than 30 centimeters of the velocity. If you see compared to the opposite side, then we can always say that there is focal arterial stenosis. These are the different acoustic window where we can perform, but this middle transtemporal is, or posterior transtemporal is something which routinely used, where you can look at the TCT values. Other values include the pulsatility index and the resistivity index, which are uniform to most of the Doppler studies what we do. If you obtain a good waveform, the machine itself will give the PI. PI is nothing but peak systolic velocity minus end-diastolic volume divided by mean MFV, and normally it is between 0.5 to 1.19. Resistivity index is given by formula peak systolic velocity and the end-diastolic volume divided by PSV. Values less than 0.8 is considered normal. Other areas up to 0.6 and 0.7 is commonly taken. Then based on this vasospasm, this MFF velocity have been given. This is obtained, I mean, generally what I used to do when I was in IMANS is we used to keep this chart available to look for the degree of vasospasm. So any velocity marking. So the most important thing in TCT is to obtain a curve like this. This is very important. So this is the peak systolic velocity. This is the end diastolic volume and end diastolic velocity. So in any intracranial circulation, this is very important. There is least resistance to the blood flow in the brain. Even with the diastolic end diastolic this thing, there is definitely forward flow. This line will not come to the baseline or will not go reversible. In cases of raised ICP, you can see this, the velocity also increases. The PSV is now 411. So once you obtain a good curve like this, you can manually keep the cursor at the peak systolic or the end diastolic volume, and it will give all the values. What is the depth? What is the resistivity index? What is the pulsatility index? What is the mean index? That is the MFV. This is MF, mean TCD is MFV. All these values will be obtained. In a case of brain dead, there can be, you know, reversal of flow. That is, the diastolic flow can be seen below the baseline or may be completely absent. So this is totally operator dependent. We have to keep doing this on every patient. And the most important thing is to obtain this kind of curve. Especially this is possible with distal MCA or the MCA bifurcation. You will definitely get this kind of curves. So with that, I end my talk. If I have any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Shivakumar. It was a quite excellent and a quite exhaustive session today, and you covered most of the probably the practical aspects what we actually deal in critical care scenario. Any questions from the audience are welcome. Till probably we'll have some time for question answers, maybe about 5 minutes or so.
Yeah, sure. Or even if we want to come back with any question, I'll write my email ID. You can always mail me.
Sure, sure. Sometimes this MRI, MRV, they see a lot of anatomical variation, which might mimic as a thrombus, or a thrombus may be missed as an anatomical variation. How common is it, or how do we differentiate them?
Especially the transverse sinus, very frequently we see this hyperplastic transverse sinus. That is quite common. We either ask, if you see any of those kind of hyperplastic transverse sinus, we ask for any prior imaging if it is available, or was there any history of previous headache or admissions or vomiting in that particular patient. If you don't have any prior imaging, and if you don't see any parenchymal changes in terms of old hemosiderin staining in that area, I think we are pretty okay. Probably it's a developmental hyperplastic one, or sometimes there could have been a previous partially occluding thrombus which has now partially recanalized. I think that is okay. Unless we are not seeing any associated signal changes in the brain parenchyma, we are in a pretty good position. But it is always good to look at the cortical veins also in the same setting. Many a times what happens is when we do MR venogram without contrast, only the dural sinuses are well shown. But the cortical veins are something which if we want to see, if you do a good contrast MR venogram, we will definitely get excellent result in on imaging. So if the clinician thinks that, you know, it is very important to look all the cortical and the dural venous sinuses, it is always good that we do contrast MR venogram.
Thank you.
I have one question. DWI player mismatch, what we see, the outcome with the thrombolysis using DWI player mismatch is not shown. Why it is so? Even though MR is very clear that we can get the, it is below 4.5 hours, but outcome is not shown when we are done thrombolysis with DWI player mismatch.
Now there are quite a few issues with this mismatch. I mean, though it is, says that, you know, if you see a clear mismatch, the onset of stroke is less than 4 or 4.5 hours, but it depends on what type of MRI has been utilized, whether it's a 0.2 Tesla or a 1 Tesla or a 1.5 Tesla. See, most of these mismatches, if you ask me, are the published articles are based on 1.5 T's. That is more or less standard. So if you have a good strength magnet, then you can definitely rely on that.
Okay.
So any case, I think you think that, you know, thrombolysis is something which you are contemplating, it is always good to look for perfusion.
Okay.
Perfusion is something which...
Even with the perfusion DWI perfusion mismatch, when they saw with the T max around less than, I think, 4 seconds or even 6 seconds, I think, even there is also not shown outcome benefit with the MTT or T max.
Correct. There are other factors, I mean, that has been considered, especially I have not stopped doing neuro interventions now, but quite of my friends, they do that in somebody who is long standing hypertensive. Okay, and he develops a stroke. Okay, the problem there is the autoregulation mechanism is completely lost.
Okay,
though you see, in fact, I have seen a patient, I have identified patients within an hour of stroke. I shifted the patient to Apollo Bangalore for the neuro intervention. Within, I think, we did everything in about 1.5 to 2 hours, including the scan, MR scan. Though he vomited on MR gantry, we wanted to take quickly what is happening there. He did not develop. His outcome was very bad because he was a long-standing hypertensive. The auto-regulation mechanism, especially the leptomeningeal collaterals, also play a very important role. Because what we are talking is ischemic core. But if the auto-regulation mechanism is not good, then the cortical infarcts will definitely happen, and the cortical stroke will eventually become more and more obvious, and that's where the outcomes are very bad.
Okay.
I think apart from this imaging modalities, the other factors also plays a lot of role in this.
Do you recommend DWI PWI mismatch related thrombolysis? Do you recommend if you don't know the onset of time?
I think if you don't know the onset of the time, the first thing is to look at, you know, is there any major bleed or not? Hematoma, hemorrhagic stroke, is there or not? If there is no bleed, then we have to look at what is the extent of the stroke, either on CT or MRI. If you look at diffusion, if it is involving more than 1/3 of MCA territory, obviously these patients will not do well. Even though we will be successful in opening up the vessel, either this patient will develop reperfusion injury or post-procedure related hematoma. That is also because once you open up...
My question is, mismatch is there. Obvious mismatch has been seen in the MRI. But onset of time is not known. Do you recommend for thrombolysis, IV thrombolysis?
Yes, we can go, we can definitely rely on MRI findings, definitely. If not IV, at least intra-arterial can be definitely given a try. Now I think intravenous up to 4.5 and 5 hours people are doing intravenous thrombolysis, the results are also good. But if you think that apart from the perfusion diffusion mismatch, there is a major clot sitting in the vessel, that is when the outcomes may not be good. So in that scenario, apart from diffusion perfusion, it is good if we obtain a good angiography study, CTR, MR angiography, and look at the vessel lumen also. So remember, the four P's should be kept in mind. It's not just the parenchyma. We have to look at the vessels also, and then only make a decision.
One question, last question actually. If we have both CT scan and MRI, what is your sequence of stroke sequence for all our audience? Both have now. So patient is acute stroke. What is the sequence of?
If you think that you have definitely time to do an MRI, then don't waste in doing CT scan. Directly take the patient to MRI, do T1 axial, T2 axial, flare axial, diffusion, susceptibility weighted imaging, perfusion, and MR angiography.
Okay.
If you time it properly, it should be over in 20 minutes.
Okay. Yeah.
I think there are no more questions. Just a small this thing. As both the CT and MRI are available, which is a better tool to for evaluate vessels, angiogram, CT angio or MR angio?
I think MR angio will be good because it's radiation free, first thing. Because CT will definitely give at least 70 to 90 ml of iodinated contrast, which eventually is not good at any given point of time. But the only advantage with CT is that it is very fast.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Shivkumar. It was a very a wonderful talk by you, and probably it cleared most of our doubts. That's the reason people are not asking many. And thank you for accepting our invitation also. Thank you so much.
One point here, actually, even though everywhere radiologist will not be there, so we have to identify the acute problems as early as possible, especially with acute ischemic stroke or intrasubmucosal hemorrhage or subarachnoid hemorrhage. So before waiting for radiologist, at least you can pick up the signs according to the patient condition and start treating, and then you can try to take a opinion on radiologist. That is more important from all the students actually. So we have to know CT scan, and we have to know MRI also. It is MRI is now everywhere. It's not like not available everywhere. It is available now. With the sequence also, you have to see which is T1, which is T2, which is flare, and especially in our today's class, they have highlighted very much on sequence weighted the SWI as well as GRE, especially for the bleeds. We have to see those sequence, at least ask for the sequence when technician is doing, so that bleed can be ruled out as early as possible and consider the treatment. Excellent, Dr. Shivakumar Swami. It was a really a fantastic job actually taking care of all together. Whatever I asked, you have covered everything. Still, because definitely there is a lot of time has been taken, but it is the message has been conveyed very properly. Thank you so much for your valuable time. One more request actually, if people ask, we'll give the slides with your permission, and even we give the recording of this webinar also.
Sure,
if your And also, I request once again to come to this webinar, because TCD we want more actually, and few more things we want more. We will call you again with your when you are available time.
Okay, sure. Right. Please let me know. Right. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay.